All participants, students, faculty, teachers, and scientists, now it's a time for a Dean Sir's session on climate, soil, and water requirement in coconut.
May I start?
Yes, sir, you can start.
Can I start? Okay, good morning. Good evening to all my students and other staff members. Today we'll be discussing about the coconut under program of coconut graduate readiness program. We'll be discussing about the climate, soil, and water requirements in coconut. Okay, so and you have studied in the principles of horticulture courses in the first year itself, the area suitable for orchard crops. There you have discussed what are the important points. So first you will be seeing the weather conditions suitable to grow any other crop. Okay, then you will be seeing the soil and other water requirements, then marketing facility, transport facility to establish orchard. So for coconut also, any crop, if you want to grow, you have to study the first, the requirements of the crop. See whether it is, first you have seen in the first year itself, there is a globe you take in the Tropic of Cancer, Tropic of Capricorn, 0 to 27 degrees north and south. That is the tropical area. Then above that, up to 63, something like that. That will be a subtropical climate. Then at the end, you will find the polar zone. So that polar zone will be temperate climate. Subtropical also, sometimes it will be a subtropical climate, also a temperate climate. Okay, now the tropical climate will be, so that's the most suitable for tropical crops. Most of the plantation crops and spice crops are grown in the tropical countries and consumed in the even medicinal aromatic crops also, consumed in the temperate countries. Now, coconut is also a tropical crop. So the tropical climate is the, you have known the definition of tropical climate. See, that climate, okay, the temperature of the 12 months, in a year will be more than, average will be more than 20 degrees Celsius. In subtropical, at least 1 or 2 months will be average, will be less than 20. So that will be, so Delhi comes under subtropical climate, okay. Now our Andhra Pradesh comes in tropical climate, but hilly areas of say Ooty, Ooty, South India also have a subtropical or temperate climate because of the higher elevations, low temperatures and high humidity leads to that climate. So even for coconut, it requires more temperature and very important to know about climate requirements, other things. So when you come to crop, see the top 10 leading countries in the coconut production are the Indonesia, Philippines. See, they're all under tropical climate. India, Sri Lanka, and Brazil, and Vietnam, Papua New Guinea, and then Mexico and Thailand. See, all these are having coastal areas. All these countries, tropical areas with the coastal climate. And then another one is the tropical climate, temperature will be more than average of 28, 25 like this. Okay, now, so Indonesia tops a very, very good climate, more rainfall. And then Philippines also heavy rainfall area in India. So here, we'll come to climate. Next slide, please. Next slide. Kalpana, move to next. So the top countries, Indonesia, Philippines, India, Sri Lanka, Brazil. Sri Lanka will be almost all zero. That is central. Please, Kalpana, move on to. Hello, Kalpana, share the second slide.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, and in Andhra Pradesh, when you come to India, you can see the map. These all coconut growing states are in the coastal area only. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Kerala, Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, Andhra Pradesh, West Bengal, even.
Second only.
Orissa, then like that, even in northeastern.
Gujarat.
It's grown, and again in India.
Hello.
area production productivity India. Even in area and production also, again Kerala tops. So 50% area will be in. So the coconut producing states in India. Okay, see all having all the states which are having coastal climate near to sea. Okay. So then I come to Andhra Pradesh. And when I come to area production productivity, the productivity is good. Okay, in Andhra Pradesh, productivity is good, but production, but the total area is less, and so total production is also less. Whereas Kerala, large area grown, and production is also more, but thing is productivity is less. So followed by this Kerala, followed by Karnataka, and then Tamil Nadu, Andhra Pradesh like this. So this is the total area is around hectares, maybe 21 lakhs, 2 million hectares is there. And productivity is nuts per hectare. Average, India average is 9,897 nuts per hectare. So one, it mostly is grown in 18 to 8 area or 8 meters or 7.5 meters area. This is the spacing. So for hectare, maybe around 150 to 160 plants, it is grown. Then this is about area and production productivity. Next slide, please. Again, within the in Andhra Pradesh, which are the districts which is grown. So in come to districts of only coastal Andhra Pradesh, coastal areas of Andhra Pradesh. So that's East and West Godavari, Srikakulam, Visakhapatnam, Vijayanagaram, Krishna, and Guntur. Even a little area is Prakasam, Nellur also border. And surprisingly, we can see it is grown in Chittoor area also. Chittoor near Chittoor, surroundings of Chittoor, near to border to Bagalkota, Bangalore area, that area also, largely grown in Chittoor. And small parts of the Karnool, Orakhol area, it may be a very little area, even in small parts of the Kadapa, where in hilly areas, maybe Chitwell area, where rivers are there, small area, maybe 84 hectares like that. It's grown. But large area is grown in East Godavari, West Godavari, Srikakulam, and Visakhapatnam, Vijayanagaram, and then Krishna. That is the climate, most suitable climate for the coconut. So then, you can see a large, small area grown in Kadapa, that productivity is higher. So when you grow, even when you compare Kerala, this crop is grown mostly under rain-fed conditions. Even in hilly areas also it is grown without irrigation. That's why production is, productivity is less. But in Andhra Pradesh, where rainfall is less, in Kerala, you will get 3 times higher the rainfall of our state. So they are able to grow under rain-fed conditions. But if they give irrigation in summer, it is very, they give a good yield. But in hilly areas on the top, they cannot give irrigation. So still they are growing the crop because that is the most economical crop. That's where they grow. But in Andhra Pradesh, you cannot grow under rain-fed conditions. But it is grown under rain-fed conditions in Srikakulam district, Udanam area. But where the yield is less. But in other parts of the state, say, other parts of the other districts, it cannot grow in rain-fed conditions. So you may get very less yield. That's why, and the East and West Godavari, Vijayanagaram, and all areas, Krishna area, they grow under irrigated conditions with the most suitable climate. Next slide, please. So the East Godavari is giving very high yield, very high productivity. That is the most suitable area for this. Series of coconut. So it's, as you know, we call it as a Kalparuksha. In the very school days, it will be very interesting, and our teachers will be telling about coconut. So very auspicious, very part of the plant is auspicious. Coconut, coconut oil is also very good for health. Contains rich in amino acids that give good health. That's why the lifespan of the Kerala people is more than as that is edible oil for Kerala people. It's good for confection also, oil. Copra is also, very good making chutney, all these things. And then even the fiber, you prepare a lot of items with fiber, coconut fiber, very economically useful to our people. Even beverages you can make, food, shell is also used for different purpose, wood is also used for different purpose, even for house construction. So every part of the plant, even in when we were children, we used to play with the leaves will be made into different items, toys. So with these coconut leaves, they will be, in those days, artisans used to come and prepare in front of us coconut leaves using so many boxes like that. So we used to enjoy those days. So every part of the leaf and even that leaf ribbon will be using for sweeping purpose. So every part of the plant is useful. And frankly speaking, coconut is a really kalpataru for and we can grow even in our area, Rayalaseema area, and areas also grown in households here and there in temples. So they will be using for any festival is there or any function, marriage function is there, the plants will be taken and they will be used for that function. You know, every part of the plant is used. You can read exclusively for that. That's okay. Now we'll come to area. So the climate requirement of the crop. For any crop, first you see the different climatic factors. So whether it is within a tropical climate or subtropical climate, like for horticulture crops. But for many other crops, there is no hard and fast rule. For example, take grape. It can be grown in subtropical climate, tropical climate, and also temperate climate. Grape, you can see best example of subtropical. But you can see even banana also can be grown in tropical and subtropical climate. Guava also can be grown in subtropical, tropical. There is no hard and very fast rule for that. But this crop cannot be grown under subtropical climate where the temperature goes less than 15 or centigrade. So the flowering will be affected. The growth will be affected. Even similarly, cashew also. If you grow, temperature is less than 15 degrees Celsius, the growth will be very less. So even if it is more less than 10, very, very poor yield you will get it because of low temperatures, plant growth will be affected. Even beetle vine also, you cannot grow when the temperature goes less than 10 degrees Celsius. The growth will be very slow. So similarly, our coconut crop cannot grow under low temperature. That's the first. So latitude. So it will be from 0 to 27 degree, north and south. That area is the most tropical climate, where you will get abundant rainfall, where you will have the, see even Sri Lanka with zero. And then above that, our India. So up to 27, up to Nagpur, that is area. But exceptions are there, exceptions. See, I told in the beginning, that can be grown in West Bengal, coastal climate, Northeast states and Gujarat also. So there are, where the climate is, where nearness to sea and good humidity is there, it will compensate. So most area is in 20 degree north and south of the latitudes, okay? Beyond this reason, so you will get it's not recommendable for commercial scale, but you can grow, still you can grow. Okay, so when that is the this thing, then altitude. So generally up to 1,000 feet you can grow, but most suitable is 500 to 600, they're the most suitable area, 600 feet above the mean sea level, meters above mean sea level. Let's say, see, for example, I will tell you, take for example, cashew. So if you grow at higher elevations, what will happen? Temperature will come down. When the temperature is less, plant will not grow. See, same will take our Srikakulam, our Visakhapatnam district, where near the sea, you can grow cashew very well. Even coconut, banana, all are the comes up. These crops, banana, cashew, and coconut, all are the crops requiring more humidity for their growth. And average temperatures, tropical temperatures. When you grow to the Chintapalli area, you cannot grow cashew because temperature goes to less than 10 in that area. But then come down to Narsipuram, Narsipatnam, that area is a very good area for cashew. Similarly, under high altitude conditions, this can be grown up to 1,000 meters also, coconut, okay? And 600 meters above the best crops, even Mysore area, Mayanda, Mysore, that area, in Karnataka, it's largely grown on about 600 meters to 900 meters in sea level, okay? So that's why altitude also play a major role. Altitude, some crops like a potato, for example, potato. You grow in Kharif under plains. Okay, average temperatures will be there. Winter, so it comes. When it, again, it cannot be grown in Kharif in hilly areas. and Kharif Rabi because low temperatures will be there. In hilly areas, you can grow in summer potato. So because potato also require some subtropical climate. So you can grow under summer, that is the most average temperatures up to till rainy season. So like this, so you can have always a plan for any crop. You have to plan whether it is a high altitude area, then the climate will be, there will be distinct seasons, cool climate, hot climate, or summer, winter, rainy season like that. But sir, Bangalore climate or some areas, there will not be distinct climate. Almost all temperature will be similar like that. So where tropical crops can be grown. But if you want to grow under a cool climate, this crop will not come. So this crop requires definitely a high temperature area, but even high altitude area with the normal temperatures, it's not going beyond 10, that can be grown. So the germplasm, they mentioned it's Karnataka is having a lot of germplasm at an altitude of 291 meters mean sea level. Now temperature is a very important factor for any crop to grow because it will influence on the growth and productivity of the farm. So many crops, so if it is high temperatures, then definitely the pollen will be affected, the fertilization will be affected, the growth will be affected, desiccation will be there. Because of more evapotranspirations from the leaf, from the plant. So the plant need more and more moisture. If there is no moisture, plant will disappear. That will happen even in Andhra Pradesh also. Sometimes in some years, mango plants are dying. So in arts, if you observe clearly, if irrigated, they may not die. Under rain-fed conditions, mango crops will be dying on the western side of the orchard because of the high temperatures, coupled with the desiccated winds, hot winds in summer, maybe May, June. So leads to the other plants. So here also, high temperatures will lead to poor production. So now, and then humidity play a major role. Nearness to sea, naturally, humidity will be more near sea, up to 80 meters or 100 miles, 100 kilometers or 80 kilometers like that. So then if you go for high altitudes also, humidity will be more. So then, and near to sea, the rainfall is also generally higher. For example, if you take an Andhra Pradesh, you will get more rainfall in Srikakulam, Vijayanagaram, Visakhapatnam, you come down, Krishna. So then the south, you come to south, Anantapur, you receive less rainfall. So the, if you go beyond sea also, you will get less rainfall. So near to sea, it's more humidity will be there, more rainfall will be there. So these crops requires a good amount of rainfall, more than 1,000 mm. Okay, Kerala receives around 250 to 300 centimeters rainfall. Where we receive, Andhra Pradesh receives maybe around, in some Anantapuram, 50 centimeters average. Maybe Visakhapatnam, Vijayanagaram district, maybe 90 or 100 centimeters. So this area can be grown. We are able to grow because of the supplementary irrigation. We are giving irrigation and we are growing the crops. So if Kerala also, though they are getting 2-3 times higher rainfall than us on the Pradesh, but they are growing under the rain-fed conditions, the yields are low. But we are growing with less rainfall and irrigation conditions. So we are giving enough irrigation. So we are able to grow this crop with successfully. So that is the reason. We'll come back to cold weather. So injury to falls below the 0 Celsius, it desiccates the foliage. The plant will not survive. Okay. With 0 degree Celsius, okay, even less than 10 also, humidity, that is the most important. Completely humidity required more than 70. That's why this crop cannot be grown in Rayalaseema area, drought area. We will recommend, so many farmers will be asking us, sir, we want to grow coconut. This is a non-traditional area. We should not recommend coconut in the dry areas, okay, except under near sea coast, near sea, because it requires more humidity, more water, more rainfall, then optimal temperatures. Okay, so that's why and not cool winds, at least afternoon, and it's not hot winds. So that's why you cannot recommend for the tropical, tropical districts, tropical area, even tropical area, dry areas, drought-prone areas like Anantapuram, all Rayalaseema, you cannot expect to get it good yields, except near to sea, and then with high humidity area, with supplementary irrigations. Okay. Next, Kalpana, temperature that you take out, humidity fast. Slide, please. Next, humidity also. Okay, when heavy rains are there, heavy humidity is there, naturally decay of the plant, it takes place in Sumatra, that area. So naturally, if high humidity is also 100% humidity, also not good. Because when more moisture is there on the in the atmosphere, the diseases will germinate. The diseases will germinate on the leaf itself. What will happen when the humidity is there? Dew forms on the leaves. And the dew forms on the leaf, the fungus will grow on the leaves. So immediately spot diseases will come. Even banana also, that leaf spot will come on the leaf itself. If the dew is there for night times in winter, the dew will be there. So fungus will grow. So when there is more dew, definitely naturally you will get more diseases. When there is a dry climate, you will get the sucking pests in the dry climate, even in any season. Sucking pests like thrips and mites and all things you will see on chilies, on even on coconut also, that mite will be there, sucking pests. So this is a problematic when you can very easily observe. When there is more rainfall, rain means insect will wash away. Insect will wash away, but disease will come. Immediately you take care of with fungicide, you should protect the plants from leaf spot diseases and other diseases, anthracnose and all these things. When there is a dry climate comes, immediately you have to protect your crop. New growth of the plant, and there is a so immediately you have to protect from the new growth of the plant with insecticides. That's you should always remember. When you are having nursery, then you will very easily, you know, when there is a more rain, you will get more diseases. And there is a just stress conditions or dry conditions, you will get the sucking pests, thrips and mites and all things. They absorb and they suck the sap and they make the plants. Next, Kalpana, sunshine, go ahead. Okay, in 1000 mm or 100 centimeters rainfalls, that is a required. And equal distribution of rainfall is more important than how much rain you are receiving. That's not more important. The distribution, monthly distribution, equal distribution in all the months, that is more important. See, in summer, there is sufficient. Even though you get more rain in the rainy season, but when you don't get rain in summer, 3-4 months, the plant growth will not be good. Definitely, it will suffer. The crop will show symptoms very clearly. When you have a coconut plant, you know, in our house, please observe, if you don't, the plant will tell you, will turn to yellowish color when it wants nutrients. It will show you when it is when the water is not sufficient, the plant will show you dry symptoms. And when there is no nutrient sufficient, the plant will show yellow symptoms or color changes. So you can very clearly, the plant will talk to you, the coconut plant will talk to you when you observe them clearly, because I did only my MSc, BSc from Tirupati and Pantanagar MSc. So I have not seen that crop growth, all the things. So when I went to Jagatiala, we have coconut plants in the college front, that area roadside. So roadside. So we have started giving young plants, So we started giving once in 4 months all nutrients, one time chemical fertilizers, one time organic, and like that mixes. So, and we're giving irrigation. So when in summer, when you don't give irrigation, then it requires at very frequent intervals. Plant will turn to yellow, and so the plant is very sensitive. It shows the symptoms, hungry, the nutrients or water. You can, if you work with them, with that crop, you can understand what is requirement, all the things. So even during seedlings growth also, it requires good amount of rainfall, because for the germination, it takes more time. Okay, if rainfall continuously there, naturally dampening will take place, okay? And water stress also results into some problems, wilting. So when naturally in the nursery, you will be putting water regularly, because every day you have to put at least one day after, every day alternate day you have to put water for young plants, young seedlings, okay? So up to 2-3 years you have to take care. So 1 year old seedlings generally they will take for planting. So if it is a dry area, you must give irrigation, otherwise plant will not survive. Okay. Establishment of the farm. Next, sunshine. Sunshine also, abundant sunshine required. When you grow coconut and with cashew and some coconut, in some have seen coconut and cashew, coconut and other crops. So when there is a sunshine, the yields have been reported reducing. So the crop grew lacking. But anyway, this is a tall growing crop. And so it requires good sunshine, more than 7 hours per day. So that will be distribution, at least average 120 hours per month. In winter, it may go to 120 hours per month. But to summer, you may have a 12 hours or 11 hours as a 8 or 10 hours as a sunshine. So totally per year, it will be around 2000 hours per year. So when there is a more sunshine, more sunlight, naturally temperature, leaf surface will go. Naturally more evapotranspiration and plant requires more moisture for the plant. It takes from the soil, okay? So if it is grows, but if there is no moisture in the soil, plant will show wilting symptoms. That's why if it is under shade conditions and cloudy regions, the plant growth will not be good because it will be lean and lanky growth and it will not give you good yield also, good production. There will be productivity less. Next, wind also very important, and because wind is also play major role in the pollination of the crop. Now different winds, if it is near sea or near coast, in the coastal climate, you will get a wind of high speed because of cyclones. Sometimes damage to the plant will be there. Okay. And in drought areas, you will have a wind in the summer, it will be high temperatures. So it increases the drop, button drop, okay. And then poor fertilization, because pollen will die under desiccating temperatures. So near to sea, see, you have seen the photographs, how the plants have been uprooted towards from the crown, okay. Very violent storms will cause. So there's a lot of damage has been observed by the cyclones also. The farmers are also getting a lot of loss. So these are the calamities, natural calamities. Next slide, please. So again, nearness to sea. There's naturally, when you know that it is the crop is grown near to the seas. And it will be impression that it cannot be grown inland areas, I mean away from the seas, but it can be grown away from the areas also with good humidity, at least optimum humidity, rainfall, and average temperatures. So, but near to sea, the problem is okay, good climate, humidity, rainfall, all things, but only these violent storms, that is the problem. Okay, next, there will not be much, but near to sea, there will not be any much fluctuations. So that's why in Srikakulam, Visakhapatnam area and Bapatla area, you can do grafting. See, for example, mango and cashew, these crops, you have to do grafting under temperatures of more than 16 degrees Celsius, night temperatures low. So, but if you go to Ashurapeta or Kammam, Hyderabad area, the temperatures goes less than 15 degrees Celsius. So the graft success is very poor. Even that graft success also very slow growth is. But in Bapatla and Visakhapatnam area, you can grow the nursery throughout the year because near the sea, the diurnal variations are less. So that nursery can be survived throughout the year. That is a good thing. That's a good thing. So near to sea, you will not be having too low temperatures, or you will not be having too high temperatures because the sea breeze will come and change the atmosphere. There is the most very good climate for that. Okay, now we'll come to soils. Soils. So different, as you know, you have studied in the first year different types of soils. One is black soils, red soils, sandy soils, and then alluvial soils and laterite soils, like the different soils. And again, the soils, you'll find that when you take the
texture, the soils. In the soil, you will find sand, then clay, loam, and coarse sand and fine sand. These are the four types you can see: coarse sand, fine sand, clay, and loam. Okay. And when there is a color, it may be red or the black. All these things. Generally, black soils, alluvial soils contain, especially alluvial soils contain more clay, more loam, and then black soils also contains more than red soils. This clay and loam content. That's why they are very sticky and all these things. So laterite soils generally will be red soils, rocky soils in western climate, west to west coast conditions, and where the crops are grown. Okay. So sandy soils near the sea, they are also called littoral soil. Littoral soils means when you go deep, at least 2-3 meters complete sand means it's called littoral soils. Okay. Sandy, there are different types. Alluvial, as you know, rich in clay and loam content. They are rich in also nutrients also. They are rich in nutrients also. That is, the organic matter will be more. If organic matter is more, they give you good yield. But there you should have a drainage problem. So there should not be, you should have a drainage facility so that you can, there should not be, of course, coconut will tolerate the stagnation of water for 10 days also. That's a good climate. You should take the depth of the soil also. 1 meter, more than 1 meter, without 2 meters, up to without any rocky layers, that's most good for crop growth. Okay, pH also 5.5 to 7 is good. If more than that, crop will not grow properly. That's why black soils will have problem of more pH. And red soils are poor in nutrients, always. Red soils are poor in nutrients, but without any problem of pH, then there will not be any problem. pH will be optimum. So that's why in red soils, if you apply more and more nutrients very frequently, so you will get more yield. In black soils, good in nutrients, okay, rich in nutrients, but there will be a problem of some type of black soils, alkali or salinity. So you should take care. If there is any alkali salinity, you should apply other amendments so that you can reduce the pH. And then more available, more nutrients will come to available to our plants. That is the thing. So next we'll go to the next one, soils. So heaviest clays, okay. Even this, you see, very interesting. This crop is going, when you go to Kerala, in the swamp, back soils, backwaters of that area, also you'll find growing this. Coconut. Even in some of the farmers I've seen in paddy lands, they make a bunch and then they put coconut and they grow like that. But you can see in Kerala and the hilly areas as well as in the waterlogged areas. So both extreme waterless conditions and waterlogged conditions also. So that can be suitable to both the climates with proper drainage. Okay. Next, please. Sites. Even if you come to our own soils, you can see description of soils in both the in Indian India and as well as Andhra Pradesh. In Andhra Pradesh, West Godavari, East Godavari, most alluvial soils. Okay, most clay and silt. Then come to West Godavari districts, Vedavig area, sandy loams or sandy clay soils. So that is the one thing. So now here there is a description, coastal sandy tract with a high water table. That is the east coast, western east coast near to sea. So mostly red soils, all the things. Then clay reclaimed with soil, high water table. Travancore, Cochin area, Malabar area. Then sandy soil with low water table, hilly slopes of South Canara and Kerala areas. So naturally, hilly areas will be having maybe sandy soil, but low water table. I mean, poor water table. Now, laterite and loamy soils with low hilly slopes of west coast. Almost all west coast area is laterite soils. There, not only this, our coconut, other cashew nut and arecanut, nut, and also mango are grown in the laterite soils. Okay, but they get more rainfall and more also distributed rainfall. More distribution of the rainfall is, that's why the crop is survived. Okay, the crop gives good yield and more yield. So now,
Now, water requirements. So this, when you come to this coconut crop, it requires, it's extremely, this crop requires more water, more rainfall, and more care and more nutrients and more protection from the vertebrates as well as from the disease and pests. So you have to protect from the animals also, a lot of animals, from monkeys and rodents and squirrels and parrots. So you have to protect like this. And then you have to also protect from the lot of insect pests. See, now, Rugoro white fly, you know, it's a problem. Previously, there was a problem of mites. Then still it's a problem. And then little borers, and then there's so many problems. If we take caterpillar, some problems are there. Even disease also, Conrad Ganoderma, like that. This is also a problem. So even mycorrhiza problem also there. So many problems are there in growing a coconut. And when you grow under because this is a perennial crop, you have to grow for, this can be grown for years together. When you are growing a single crop for years together on the same side, naturally so many pests and diseases will come and will multiply. It's not the case with the cereals. Cereals where you can do rotation and you can protect the crop from various diseases and pests very easily. But being a perennial crop, it's a plantation crop, so naturally so many pests and diseases. When you control the one pest, another pest, another minor pest will become major. That is what is happening. So that is the thing. Okay. So the irrigation, so we have discussed earlier, this crop requires good amount of water. So without water, you will get less yield. That's why I told you around it requires about 60 liters, in, maybe 78 liters in summer, maybe 40 liters of water in other seasons, so very humid climate. So in drought area, in drought conditions, so there are various methods, various experiments have been done, adding so many organic manures, adding so many amendments to the soil, so that they hold the, even shells of coconut, putting in the basins, then putting there. So they holds the even husk of the coconut. So it takes more than 3 times of its weight, more water it keeps in the soil. So when you put it in the soil and so when you irrigate it, or when the rain, it takes more water, and in the summer it gives you that. So there are so many methods, and even soil conservation. So water should not grow from our field to other field, always remember. So it's Kerala and West Coast, that area is mostly hilly areas they grow. So naturally water will be flowing. So to control the runoff, they grow pineapple crops, they grow ginger and turmeric on the hilly areas and rain-fed conditions. Even pineapple also under rain-fed conditions. So they stop the irrigation water, they stop there. So it goes into, it percolates into the deeper layers of the soil. So that's why when, as it is a slopey area crop there, so they take all the measures to check the water so that it controls, it goes into the deep into soils, and it will be absorbed in the soil and it will be available in the summer. So for that, at the basin of the plants, they prepare different types of the beds, okay? And then they put in the bed in the inside the amendments, so many fiber, husk and waste material of that, it will absorb, and there's a various factors responsible for that. So of course, water requirements again vary with the climate. In winter requirement, no, because the evapotranspiration nozzles are less, temperature is less. So here also, these things factor play. And type of soil, in some sandy soils, it requires more water, I mean more frequent water. See, that's and that's why, so different methods of irrigation, generally flood irrigation, then drip irrigation, and sprinkler irrigation, so on. But mostly where irrigation, because in east and west coast, especially east coast area, in our west coast or east coast, we have a good amount of water. So we don't go for drip irrigation, but we go for only flooding. But in Srikakulam area, I have seen some gardens with the drip irrigation, and the instead of drippers, they have put small micro sprinklers, and so they are putting water, they have four nozzles, four drippers for the plant on four sides of the plant, and putting good amount of water. So the plants are excellent, I've seen. So flooding, okay, but because if you do flooding,
then a lot of weeds will come, and then that again management problem. Evapotranspiration losses will be there. So then some of that basin, if you follow also, that's good. To some extent, you will be reducing the wastage of water, and then wastage of nutrients, and labor will be reduced. So that's one. See method based in how they're irrigating. The plant only. So that's okay. Once in 4 days, they have to irrigate it. So leaving 1 or 2 feet near to the basin, you make a basin around the tree. And in that basin only, you have to put the fertilizer also. When you're applying fertilizers, you should not put the near to the trunk. You should away at least 1 foot or 2 feet or 2.5 feet. And with the age of the plant, maybe 2.5 feet, 3 feet like that. So that depending on the root distribution, maybe 2 feet or 3 feet in that area, you have to put the fertilizers, you have to do irrigation there only. So that's the one thing. The basin also requirement also, where the abundant rainfall, abundant water is available, the canal system, so they do like this. But in some drought area, some areas of West Godavari and upland areas, where they grow,
sir, voice is not audible, sir. Mic is.
Now okay? Now
audible? Yes, sir.
Okay.
Now okay, sir.
Now okay. So complete sprinkler is not good. So that's not a method. So drip irrigation with 4 dippers. Instead of dippers, you can have a micro sprinklers. Now it will be there, and so giving good water on 4 sides of the plant will do, you can to yield a good crop, a good growth, and all the things. So, and in the basins only you can apply fertilizers, all the things. There's one method. So, still advanced people that develop fertigation through water only. So, there is a schedule of that fertigation also, because again, depending on the climate, depending on the age, and depending on the season. So once in a week or once, like that, they dissolve the these soluble chemicals in a bucket. They put the they give. So just before there are the end of the drip irrigation. So at the end, so they give, and all chemicals will go like that. In the beginning, they don't give you. In the last only, they give fertilizers, dissolve chemicals. They go to the they reach the plant, and last half an hour like that. So that way, it has to be planned. Again, it varies with the season to season and age of the crop. Again, fertigation problem comes. So again, if you start giving fertigation also, then this drip irrigation, you have to clean it, that pipes, all the things, because sometimes they flood it, and you have to be do again cleaning of that also. You should take care. So, and there are different methods how to, under soil moisture conditions, how to save the soil moisture also. See in Kerala, efficiency method, drip irrigation is more efficient than the flooding as well as the basin irrigation. So basin irrigation is so saving 75% of water over the flood irrigation. Okay, drip irrigation saving 85% water over the flood irrigation. But drip irrigation is also saving around 30% over the basin irrigation. Of course, water is saved, definitely. But in areas like East Godavari, where there is insufficient water, they generally reluctant to take that irrigation. So they go only basin irrigation or flooding also. Flooding, because they grow other crops also in between. So they will mostly intercrop is there, cocoa will be there. So there are other intercrops like there are so many vegetables also they grow. Gajendra, Karan, like that varieties, Colocasia. So like that alocasia, then some farmers can grow turmeric, and ginger also can be grown. So that's why they grow for flooding only, because 4 or 3 crops can be grown on the same land and at the same time. Okay. So this is a type of irrigation that you recommended, 15-20 days in black soils. Naturally, the frequency interval it will be very closer in sandy soils. So sandy soil is like that. It's a very good soil without any problems. I mean, red soils also, but requires more management on the part of the farmer. Farmer has to give frequently fertilizers. They give frequently. They should give more and more frequently. They should give water, fertilizers. They needs more care. But you can get a excellent pindikodirute. So, but other black and alluvial soils, there may be some salt problems. And if you overcome that salt problems, they are already rich in fertilizers, nutrients. So they don't need much fertilizers and water. The crop can do good. So these alluvial soils are generally very good, both in nutrient as well as soil pH is also good. That's why the delta soils of Godavari Basin, where the joining river joining in the sea, that near, of course, near the sea will have find only sand only, because there silt and clay will be gone to the sea. But a little away, you will have all clay and the silt. There is a delta soil, very good in nutrients. So that can be good suitable for our coconut crops. They are given about the percentage, all the things. So next one is fertigation also there. External power supply, okay. For adding chemicals and fertilizers in crops with existing irrigation system through drip irrigation, giving water soluble fertilizers. Even nowadays, farmers are using, even for turmeric also, they are giving fertigation dissolved. Even for banana, they started giving. They are slowly, I mean, already some work has been done on some crops. But same thing, that maybe it work has been done at West Coast and similar work also at our area also has been done. So they are using liquid chemical is applied directly with the water system. Chemical is applied venturi, with the help of venturi, so they can send it to the chemical to the our drip system. It's the most effective and least inexpensive. So okay, there will not be any wastage of fertilizer because dissolved already, it goes to the plant through water and inside the soil, it will be there. So even recommended fertilizer, you can save the 25% of the recommended fertilizers because 100% utilization is going on. So when you apply in the broadcasting or localized also, leaching will be there. Urea, some fertilizers, leaching will be there. But this, there will not be any leaching. It will be directly near the plant basin. So efficiency also more. If you give fertigation, the plant takes more and absorbs more and give you more yield. Okay. So moisture stress conditions, how that is the symptom. When under the summer conditions, you see the coconut plants in Rayalaseema, in area, dry area, see plant will be yellowing and drooping of lower leaves. I told in the beginning, plant will speak to you. It will speak to you when you observe the plants closely, coconut plants in our houses. So good green color in rainy season. If you apply more fertilizers, will be very dark green in color. Slowly comes to light green and becomes yellow in summer. So if you don't apply fertilizers, it will become not only yellow, it will be drooping of the leaves and dropping of the leaves. So that is the symptom. Stress conditions coupled with the nutrient deficiency symptoms. Okay. Next slide, please. So increase in rate of frond setting. Okay. So that's it. Even without the cyclone, it looks like a cyclone effect. So naturally, water stress is there. So the plant production of leaves reduced. That's the leaves we call frond. So frond production is reduced. One leaf will give you one bunch, one spade, one spathe. Okay. So yield depends on the good number of leaves. So when coconut also, you should not cut the leaves. You should be very careful. It takes to come out one leaf may take around 12 to 16 months. So every month one leaf will come. So at near base of the one leaf, you will get a one inflorescence. So if you don't care for a few months, that effect will be there, not immediately. It will be there, effect will be there after 1 year or 6 months. So that's why if now there is a stress or moisture now, so this effect will not find immediately, but you will find after maybe 1 year or like that. So similarly, if this is cyclone, immediately you will not find. Maybe already whatever inflorescence is there, you may give yield, but later it will suffer. So that's why constantly you should take care for getting the constant yields throughout the year. So effect of moisture stress, shedding of the buttons. See, most of the people will be asking you dropping of the female buds. Female bud, female flowers, flowers are called buttons. So young nuts, so smaller shed nuts, and naturally in the beginning of the ages. So maybe 5, 6, 7 nuts, the dropping is more. Then if there is a high temperatures also they will drop, because pollination requires, then wind also required, and less moisture also leads, and less nutrients also leads to dropping of the buttons. And sometimes diseases, pests also leads to, and then even pests also. So you should take care of all the things. And people come and say, we will apply, we will do some treatment, so nothing is there. So many people will be applying salt to the plants. Please don't apply salt to the plants, because this crop requires more potassium, because it is having, the plant is having more fiber. So fiber requires more potassium. This crop requires more potassium, so that you should apply only potassium, and to some extent sodium displaces the functions of the potassium. That's why they apply. But in sandy soil, even if you apply salt, then immediately, because of more water that goes away, sodium effect will be there. It does the functions of sodium. But in drought prone area, if you apply salt, plants may not come. For that crop may give you yield, but next crop onwards, plant may give you poor yield or die also. So that's why don't recommend salt to the coconut soils, coconut plants. Please remember that. Okay. So conservation, mulching is the best method. Coconut dust, coconut leaf, dried husk, all the things. Naturally, they conserve more moisture. They take, and they become rotten, and they become a manure to the crop. And so addition of organic manure and tank silt. So for we used to do one time apply tank silt. Four times if you want to apply. But this once you apply tank silt, another time you apply only FIM, all these things. Another two times you can apply neem cake along with the chemical fertilizer. So like that, in rainy season, two times you can apply chemical fertilizer along with the neem cake. So like every 3 months, 4 months, you should apply, so that the plant will look, growth will be good. Cover cropping, so many common cover crops in our area, cowpea, green gram, black gram, and then grow and then put in the basin. So put water, put a mud on that, put a soil on that. So the cover crops also, you can take the crop. See, you can grow in between these crops, these pulses. You can take the yield and put the growth, that hay, stumps, all the things in the basins of the coconut. And so put some fertilizers as well as soil on that. It will become rotten. That will become a good manure to the crop. No? So even husk also. The experiments have been done in Kerala. Even coconut shells along with husk, they put in the bunds and basin, and they retain more moisture. And so the crop growth was good, even in the summer also. They got more results. See, that's photos also, mulching. And this happened in Kerala only. Most of the leaf mulching, and then husk, and then shells, all these things mulching. Next, please. Pit. So these are the different crops in the intercrops are there. Companion crops are there growing. So that way, vegetables, they become a cover crops. All the things. So it is entire ecosystem. Coconut itself is not a single crop. It is entire ecosystem. A lot of sask burial. Factors are involved in this. Coconut itself is a type of ecosystem, not a single crop. See, there you go, you're growing. Yes. Next, please. See, when there is bund system, I mean, there is terracing, the slopy soils, see, they put not only the coconut husk, then also they put the pineapple. Very important crop in West Coast area, pineapple. So it will stop the water there, and will. So it will check the runoff water, and pineapple also gives good yield, and that's it. Next, harpoon shaped bund stabilized with the pineapple. Okay, the different, this is the different conservation methods, moisture conservation methods, and it's because moisture is very important. In summer, because there will not be water, so that's why only they go rain fed conditions. They cannot provide irrigation under high elevation conditions, so they take care from the rainy season itself. So during rainy season, they grow turmeric and ginger. They are the short duration crops. They grow turmeric short duration crop in hilly areas. So they remove by December or by December end, they remove. Again, they grow, they will have the this pineapple crop. So because of this cover crops, so they turmeric, ginger or pineapple, they water will be, runoff will be affected. Water will percolate rain water into the soil, and that will be there in the soil. And so that these are the treatments they have done. Okay, next please. Tolerance to cultivars. So they have developed some that are relatively tolerant to drought. So what are West Coast tall, let's say Tiptur tall, East Coast tall, Ganga, Bondam, Green Dwarf. These are some of the crops which are having little tolerance to drought. Okay. Released varieties, Chandrakalpa, then that variety VPM3, Andaman tall, then Kalpa Mitra, Java tall. So where they are grown largely, they are named after the places. See, Java Mitra is a selection from Java, Kalpa Mitra, Java tall. But East Coast tall, where grown in East Coast conditions. Chandrakalpa is a variety from the Lakshadweep waterway, Lakshadweep. So Andaman, I mean, it's also East Coast, VPM3. So Kalpataru, selection from the tip to tall, is a drought tolerance variety. So these are the some little tolerant varieties. Again, Chandra Laksha, it is a cross between Lakshadweep Orange tall and Chogath Orange, COD. It's called COD, Chandra Chogath Orange Dwarf. And mostly there is a watery crop. Then Malayan Yellow Dwarf, MYD, then West Coast tall, Kalpa Samruddhi. But for AP conditions, these are for only maybe other conditions. For AP conditions, our Godavari Ganga, our varieties are more. So you should not take away the West Coast variety to East Coast straight away without testing. Always please keep it in mind. West Coast varieties of anything. Take cashew or take turmeric, take ginger, anything. You cannot take away straight because there, the climate is entirely different. High rainfall. Okay, more humidity and optimal temperatures. Then some varieties may success in that West Coast, may not become successful here. So because of our experience, so our East Coast area is quite different to the West Coast. East Coast area is with little less rainfall than that, and then more high temperatures. So naturally less humidity. So these climate requires other varieties which are coming up well under these conditions. So we should screen the varieties. That's why location specific is required. For that, we have the ambassador research station. So they're only the developed varieties are recommended for this crop, for our cultivation in the farmers. So this is in brief about the soil and water requirements of the crop. But in what you have to do for any crop also, any production technology, first, I request the students not to mug the things. Okay, because even our BSc AG also, I used to remember because we used to grow all the field crops in our area, and I used to remember based on the size, so how many kg seed rate required. I used to know the crop height, all the things, so how much space should be given. Like that, by you have to imitate. You have to go to the plants and you have to observe. You have to always, you cannot mug it and this is the spacing or this much read like this. So you have to read by seeing the plants. You can keep remember, oh, this is the crop. Height is this much. So this much spacing is required. And this is the nutrients required. Like that, you have to comparatively, you have to remember fertilizer, all the things. So you cannot buy hot and you cannot... you have to be very careful. See, for example, even in the varieties, like, for example, in coconut also, dwarf varieties, they require naturally less area. So that's why
you can hybrids also require always less space than the tall varieties. So that you have to compare and remember. And climate also, you have to always you have to see the first year fundamental courses, tropical, subtropical, and humid and humid. You can say polar areas, temperate areas. So what are the crops grown in that area? You have to remember. What are the qualities, characters of the temperate tropical crops? Tropical crops are generally they don't drop their leaves. Okay, subtropical and temperate crops, they drop their leaves. Okay. So in the winter season, to protect themselves from the low temperatures. So like our tropical crops, mango, all these crops cannot drop all the leaves. But apple, can say grape, and then peach and pear, they drop the leaves in winter and they give you new growth in the with the spring season, March, April. They start new growth grow, new growth will give you flowers and flower will give you fruits. So naturally temperate fruits will be available from June onwards. Even an apple, all these things will come from June, July onwards, peach, pear, plum, all the things. So there's a case different with the, our tropical crops. Tropical crops requires optimum temperatures. Okay, it requires more temperatures to grow. And they are susceptible to low temperatures. That you should remember always. Hello, Kalpana. Now it is 5:05. Can we stop? Can we stop?
Yes, sir. Thank you,
okay,
sir.
No. Thank you. You give them. We give them that slides. So right. Send them to slides.
Yes, sir. We are giving then, both PPT and also complete notes on every lecture, sir.
But they need not to by heart the Kerala seasons. But in they remember broad about our state rainfall, our state soils.
Yes.
Okay. And our state yes. climatic requirements, our state varieties.
Yes, yes.
What is that? So if they remember about that, and if they should have a comparison of West Coast varieties, West Coast climate and East Coast climate.
Yes.
So they should preferentially should know what is the West Coast climate and where East Coast climate. That's why you should do location specific research.
Yes.
These points, again, irrigation varies with the West Coast to East Coast.
Yes.
How drought is playing a major role in coconut because it is a moisture loving plant, so more
yes,
water
sir.
Requirements, more care, more management. So it's not easy to grow coconut. So they should remember that easy
yes,
is very difficult to grow, and
yes.
a lot of care should be taken to get. And also they should get habituated to take more and more coconut oil, because they get a good
yes, sir,
amino acids and their life will be. More longer. That's why Kerala people are live for longer years than us. They'll be more
yes.
healthy and intelligence also more
yes,
because
sir.
Of this coconut and also fish. So they should ask them to read some more books about the coconut. Important pests and diseases also.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, ma. Yes, yes I didn't
yes.
prepare anything. Just
yes,
whatever. Not necessary because of 10 years back, I used to teach all our UG students, okay, there's sunshine requirements, they can know some 1,000 or 2,000 hours per
yes.
year, and moisture requirements 100 centimeters. Okay, if there is in Philippines that area, maybe 2,000 centimeters, so they don't need water. But in area Kerala, though its rainfall is more, but it's only rainy season, so summer they need plants will suffer from drought, and
yes.
Andhra Pradesh. So what we are giving, though we are raising 100 centimeters, we are giving enough water. So we are getting good yield, and we are growing only in the coastal area. So we are getting good yields. We are not growing in the central part of the our state. Okay.
Yes,
so if
that's
grow,
why AP got good productivity, sir.
Yes, good productivity because of all combination of
right
moisture, humidity, temperature, all the things.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, ma.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir, for your valuable lecture. You covered in detail every topic, but because of some net problem today, some pictures we couldn't able to show to the participants. But we are going to share the PPT to every participant. And also, thank you very much, sir. You had been to your home, still you prepared for this lecture and had a good lecture to the participants, sir. Thank you.
I'm on leave, although my granddaughter is my granddaughter is making a galata, disturbing me.
Yes,
instead of that, I could spend my time with my students.
Yes, sir.
Very happy to share and ask them to go to Kokan.